Few things first before I wanted to start. Oh wow, it's good afternoon already. So you know, I was born in India, and it's been a long walk. I actually, before I got saved, I was an atheist, and one night, my best friend was crossing the street, and I spoke to her a week ago. I told her I was going to meet that night, and a bus ran over her, and you know, I got a call at 10:30 at night asking, can you come identify this dead body, because they just found a cell phone, and nobody was with her. And so went to mortuary at night and just looked at her body, and the first thing I thought was, there has to be a God. Because somewhere in my heart I felt life has to be in somebody's control. And you know, I was a Hindu before that, so I was seeking Hinduism, and I was this close. I was becoming a saint. I was gonna take saffron, lead my life as a Hindu saint. You know, I read some things that the leader of that group said, and he said, women enjoy rape. I said, I disagree with that. That's not right. I walked away. And you know, and one night I was walking on a college campus, and somebody told me, God wants to give you a big bear hug. And I kept seeking it. A month later, I gave my life to Christ. And it's been a few years now. And, you know, after that, it was not easy. It was not easy, you know, telling my family I was a Christian. The first thing they said was like, okay, take the next flight home. You got corrupted. And I did. I took the next flight home, went to India. I was there for 72 days. It was suffering. It was one of the most awful things I've been through. It was my mom was just banging her head to the bed every night, wouldn't let me sleep, because why would you become a Christian? Oh, it was awful. Just because I told her I want to serve the Lord, they wouldn't recognize my testimony, and it's awful. But praise God, He brought me out of it. He brought me out of it. And then ever since then, God, I want to serve you. He's like, not right now. I tried my way, pushed myself in ministries, wouldn't work out. And I was going to churches. One pastor told me, hey, I want to take you in. Can you write 50 sermons? Say, this is not right. My friend came and told me, it's madness. You're not doing this. You know, I was almost, before I found NCOM, I was done. I was like, God, I'm just going to be a believer, and I just need to find a church for my family. We'll just find a good church to go to. I'm done. Man, what a journey God has planned for me and for my family and for the church, for all of us. You know, God has a plan for all of us. You know, I'm telling you, if you think you're in a place where there is no tomorrow, trust me, I was there many times. I would have never seen myself here. God has a plan for you. He absolutely does. So today I want to preach on whose heart is like the king's heart. I want to jump right in. I want to talk about a guy named Dan Sickles. Anybody know who Dan Sickles is? Dan Sickles was, if you know him, you're really old. He was in the 1850s. He was a congressman from New York. So I hope nobody knows him, so that's okay. So Dan Sickles was a congressman from New York in the 1850s, and he was from a very prominent organization called Tammany Hall, and he had a sight of wanting to become a president of the United States, and he might have made it if he had not shot and killed Philip Barton Key. Key was the son of Francis Scott Key, the man who wrote the Star Spangled Banner, national anthem. He was a good friend of Sickles. He was his lawyer. He also was, he had the influence to appoint him as United States attorney. And without Dan Sickles' knowledge, he was also his wife's lover. One day on the street across from White House, Sickles met Key. He pulled out his revolver and shot him dead on the spot. That accomplished, he walked down to the street to surrender the revolver to Attorney General. The trial was a public circus, and people were debating, hey, this guy defended the sanctity of marriage or was a common murderer. And you have to remember, this was a long time back in America when people believed divorce was morally wrong and adultery was not just an affair, but one of the worst sins anybody could commit. And meanwhile, his defense team came up with a new defense. For the first time in American justice, they raised a defense of temporary insanity. They argued that the shock of finding out that his wife was untrue to him and with his best friend was so great as to render him insane, the court acquitted him. And he returned to Congress to find himself an absolute pariah. When he entered the hall, other members refused even to sit near him. He was totally ostracized. You know, it was not for murder. You see, he had done something utterly scandalous as to make shooting seem so trivial by comparison. He forgave his wife and took her back. Forgiveness. Wow. Today we'll be reading from the book of Matthew, and I've asked Brother William to be my reader. We'll be reading for the first, the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6, 9 to 13.
I'll read the King James Version, starting at verse 9. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
So I just wanted him to stop here real quick, because a lot of people, they've seen a social media post too just recently. People thought, what is God's name? It's Howard. It's hallowed, which means highly honored. It's not Howard. And people literally thought it was Howard. Sorry, I had to make that. Go ahead.
Verse 10. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So in the Lord, thank you. In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus says, your kingdom come and your will be done. It's God's kingdom and it's God's will be done. You know, in the book of Matthew, Matthew uses the phrase kingdom of heaven 32 times. And the book of Matthew was primarily written for Jews who had a misunderstanding of kingdom of God. You know, Israelites struggled with this understanding of the kingdom of God. You know, their understanding was they wanted a paradise where there will be a good crop, no drought, no taxes, all peace, a warrior king who will win wars, and nothing but blessings. You know, this sounds something like what we want. Beautiful house, good paying jobs, awesome cars, blessings in everything we do, and basically a paradise. We just want God to make us comfortable and lazy. And that will not be God's will. Just and hence not God's kingdom. In God's kingdom, God's will be done. And Jewish culture was also about following traditions and the law and the thought that received forgiveness from the law. And Israel was not prepared for the kingdom of God. Wanting a paradise meant kings changed the quality of life. And they fell. You know, if you forgive a lowly person, that is not changing the quality of my life. And some of us think that too. And in God's kingdom, we ask every day for our daily food. And some can see it as we have to request food every day. And that doesn't sound like freedom. And then forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. And a lot of us like to be independent. Some of us would like to earn our own bread and butter. Why ask God when we earn it yourself? Because regardless of who earns it, He provides. So God is your provider. Though you're earning it, you do the work. Hey, God is the provider. Similarly, God has forgiven us. He has forgiven us. He has freely forgiven us, and it is our responsibility to forgive our debtors. And we eat food daily as we are dependent on God for food daily. That makes sense, but why ask God to forgive our sins daily? Daily. We sin daily. And why forgive others daily? Hey, they sin against you daily too. Yeah, it's just how it is. And Jesus is not telling us, repeat these words after me. There is power in this verse. He's not saying, no, there's no voodoo, there's no magic in this words. He's saying, hey, there's meaning in this verse. He's showing us what we need to sincerely pray for, sincerely ask for every day. After all this, there is a question that comes to my mind, right? I mean, God, how do we forgive evil people? That's just honesty. You know, I had a friend, Tell. Tell is a youth pastor, just like Anthony. You know how Anthony is all excited, jumpy, and we were just praying in the pastor's room. Anthony held my hand so tight, my ring finger was hurting because he was squeezing my hand. He was so excited in prayer. Woo! I'm telling you, youth pastors are one of a kind. Until, with all his excitement, he meets Beth Grant. I've met Beth Grant. Beth is a leader of Project Rescue, an organization that works in different parts of the world. And they free women from sexual slavery, human trafficking. And Tell and Beth were having a conversation, and Beth was trying to recruit Tell. You meet Beth, the first thing she tries to talk to you is recruit you into going to a different part of the world. And that's just Beth. So as she was trying to have this conversation, and Tell was telling her, hey, I'll go to anywhere in the world, and I want to help this woman, I want to really be there. But he said, I can't stand these traffickers. Are these pimps? I cannot stand them. I want to kill these people. And these people destroy this woman's lives. I can resonate with his feelings. And Beth responded by saying something really powerful. She said, God wants to save these pimps' lives too. These pimps are evil men or women. Men are women. Why would God want to save these people? Why would God want to save these people? In Ephesians 6:12, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood. Yes. Flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil is the heavenly realms. We do not fight flesh and blood. These men and women are not evil. They are corrupted by evil, and they need Christ, and we need to forgive these people too. And I mean, I think you got my point pretty much that I'm going to be talking today all today about forgiveness. So jumping into my first set of verses. Deacon William, Matthew 18, 21 to 22. Oh, he doesn't, his mic does not active.
How did you want? Matthew 18, 23.
Oh, 21 to 22.
Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? Jesus said unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven.
Thank you. Peter asked, how many times should I forgive, Lord? How many times? Peter thought there was a count to forgiveness, a limit. Forgiveness has a limit. You know, he thought, you know, I'm not forgiving somebody all the time. There's a limit to forgiveness. And the church, our church has, church in general, has a good number of relationships. You know, spouses, parents, grandparents, relationships. All relationships have one thing in common. It's not love. It's imperfection. Every relationship has imperfection in common. And they thrive on these mistakes. And you know, sometimes these mistakes affect human life significantly. Our focus becomes so much on these mistakes. We have made people their mistakes. We identify them by their mistakes. And if you don't know somebody's name, a lot of times they, oh, you know that brother who cheated on his wife? We identify them by their mistakes. You know, and sometimes, you know, we look at them, you know, if somebody, a pimp or somebody has come into our church, ooh, you know who that is. They have a name, they're forgiven. We have to look at them to the identity of Christ. Have we made our unforgiveness their identity? Have we made our unforgiveness their identity? You know, we see sometimes look at somebody with tattoos and we start judging them on their past. Maybe they've had a rough past. Hey, we forgive them. We fully forgive them. And growing up in India, right, I've seen two different differences between how a boy and a girl is raised. And a girl is told her character is the most important thing. And she's told since a childhood to not pay heed to comments, to harassment or abuse, but go forward with strength and courage. And a lot of times I feel like essentially a girl child is always told to forgive regardless of their social status. A boy child is always told you have to become a man. And man has to be macho. His existence brings pride to the family. And I've also seen boys go to better schools and get better facilities than girls because he's the life of the family. And most young boys in India are taught, or I've also seen some in the US too, they're taught, you get hit, you hit back. Girls are not taught that. Girls are taught, you're taught forgiveness. And there's some significant research actually that shows that girls are taught forgiveness at younger age, whereas boys are taught revenge. I've seen some similar traits in the US too. And I just want to clarify something. Fighting for justice is different from what I'm talking about here. That's a different story. You know, a man in India, his cousin got married to his friend. He did not like his friend. He waited 10 years to kill his friend. Just because he did not like his friend. Revenge. You know, I just feel sometimes You know, we a lot of the people in our church, we understand the pains of interracial marriages. We understand the pains of interpolitical marriages, and that result in children hating their parents for their political beliefs and different things. We understand different relationships. And how many times do we teach our children, or have we learned from our parents, forgiveness? If you don't show the act of forgiveness to your children or to your parents, or your parents have never shown it, or do you never show to your friends, how can you expect that from them? You don't show it, they're not going to show it back to you. And our kids are really good at sniffing our hypocrisy. If you have never shown forgiveness to your kid, they're going to remember that. And the little kids especially, they'll point that out to you. How do they how do you expect them to forgive you? And I just want to plainly put it out. If you've never shown forgiveness, it's really hard for you to receive forgiveness. And a lot of us are in a place, you've never shown forgiveness, but you want to receive forgiveness. We all want to receive forgiveness. We've seen that time and time again. Yeah, how many times do we forgive a person? Oh, I don't know, maybe once, maybe twice. We've never shown your kid forgiveness. A friend of mine, he said he had to go ask his two-year-old child for forgiveness because he yelled at her for screaming the whole way home. And his five-year-old saw that and he remembered it. Kids learn. They grasp. Your grandkids are watching you. And when Peter asks, so revenge is a dish best served cold is what they say. But forgiveness is a warm dish that everyone deserves. When Peter asks, how many times shall I forgive Lord? There could be a time, if he's saying, it could be a time forgiveness runs out and then we take revenge. You know, when you're pushed to the wall, how many times can you forgive one person? You know, this goes against our natural instinct. At some point, you want to push back. Push back. Some point, you want to push back. What is your limit? In it's almost like, you know, Jesus says, hey, if somebody slaps one cheek, show the other cheek. We have a theory here. Hey, show one cheek, show the other cheek. The third time, he didn't say nothing about it. What are we going to do about it? Third time. There has to be, there's a point. I am strong. I'm confident. I have the strength in me. At what point? One cheek, third cheek. We're telling the ball not to bounce when it drops. If someone sins against you, you cannot be your natural self. I want to hit back at somebody. No, you can't be your natural self. And sin back at them. Peter is asking if a brother or sister sins against him. Not even somebody, but a brother or sister. And which means for us, like, hey, if a brother or sister, meant a believer, sins against me. Peter was not even concerned about the world, but he was about the brother or sister sins against me. This is a personal question, especially for church. We all have church hurt. Do you think pastor has not had church hurt? Anthony has had church hurt. Sister Virginia has had church hurt. Nefertiti has had church hurt. A lot of us have had church hurt. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In church or outside church? Inside church or outside church, all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We have a different standard for Christians in church and outside church. People outside church, oh, no, you're in church. You can't sin against me. No, you're in church. And you have higher standards of forgiveness. That's a Christian who sinned against me. That's the Christian brother who offended me. We forget sin. Pastor went too long. I'm offended. Anthony squeezed my hand. I'm offended. And it's not enough to acknowledge imperfection. We all are really good. I mean, this culture right now, we're good at acknowledging imperfection. But to forgive like Christ did, that's the most important thing. We have to equally forgive all kinds of people, Christian or not. And you know, Christian disciples, right? This is the most funny way. They stop talking to each other because they have disagreements on scripture. Let me say this, church. We are a body of Christ, and we're imperfect. We're reading a book right now with Pastor. We're imperfect. If you're an imperfect church, don't you think we're all going to have some disagreements? I might like sushi. You might not like sushi. I might like spicy food. You might not like spicy food. I understand. That's okay. I might like Pastor going long. You might not like Pastor going long. Just saying. Stop talking to each other. Hating on church. Hating on the pastor. And some leave church in pastor hate. Unable to submit to leaders in the church. Oh, you know what he said? But God put him there. God put the leader there. Hey, I'm just there. I'll serve him. Hey, if I have a disagreement with him, sit down, talk. We still have a disagreement. That's okay. What do you do if you? That's outside the world? You don't go fight people and leave. No. But in church, we have higher standards. We have congregation hate. Oh, I don't like that brother. I don't like this sister. Oh, you know them. They've hurt me. Oh, what about you? Did you forgive them? How many times did they hurt you? 10 times? 20 times? 30 times? Okay. And Peter taught, 7 times is the highest one can forgive. That brother hurt me 7 times. This is the most anyone has ever hurt me. This is the most I can ever forgive. Forgiving a person 7 times is difficult. I get it. 7 times is really difficult. One person, my wife hurts me 7 times. I forgive, man. That is still 8th time. Some of us hurt our wives 7 times in one day. And if you have a lying sibling who lies to you all the time, that's hard. Oh, we all, and ask you money all the time. You get tired, you get upset, you feel helpless at times. Forgiveness is hard, especially when you feel betrayed. Sometimes forgiveness feels like a failure. That someone got the best out of you and betrayed you and you have to forgive. Oh man, that guy got the best out of me. He took advantage of me and I still have to forgive? Yes. It's not common. It's not natural. Sometimes we forgive a person and when we look at their face, we still feel the hurt. You know, we remember the hurt and the resentment pops up. We have to forgive the person again and again for the same thing, sometimes again and again and again. And Jesus says, not 7 times. 7 times is not enough. Meanwhile, I'm struggling to forgive one person. You know, that we have one specific person in our lives. We can forgive everybody, but that one person, I don't know. I don't know, just one person, I don't know. I'm sorry, I'm picking on Anthony today. Sometimes Anthony, he's too tall. He wears nice suits. One person. We all have that one person. One person. 77 times. I mean, you know, some of us have 3 sin rule. You know, 3 sins. If somebody sins against me, 3 times. That's my patience. Yeah, life is like baseball. 3 strikes and you're out of my life. You know, why does baseball only have 3 strikes? They don't have all day. They don't have all day, but we do. You're not going away. You're going to be here tomorrow. You're going to be a day after tomorrow. What are you going to do? 3 strikes. Imagine pastor does that. 3 strikes from the congregation. three strikes in the congregation, I'm out. Pastor does it in his style. He squats, I'm out. Or the opposite. You disagree with the pastor three times. You disagree with the church. I mean, some people leave the church because they hate the church building. I don't like the church building. The seats are not comfy. I'm offended. The worship was too loud. And you know, sometimes you overhear a husband and wife having a conversation at their weak moment. Struggle to forgive. You overhear a friend talking about their sin struggles. We always struggle to forgive. You can be offended by anything these days. Hence, forgiveness should abound. Yeah. Come on now. If you are a sensitive person, it is more your responsibility to always live in the attitude of forgiveness. Come on. I'm not saying today we're going to leave here, it's going to be jolly mall, you're going to be forgiving for no one. No, it's about the attitude of forgiveness. It is the attitude we have to adopt. Every situation you see, I got to live in forgiveness. God, help me forgive. God, help me live in forgiveness. It is not easy. 77 is a journey. And 77, you know, forgiveness means releasing somebody of the ties we tied them to. It's not easy. And one last point before I move on to the next side of verses. Do you forgive people who break the law? Some of us like have that distinction. You didn't break the law. Oh, you're fine. I'll forgive you. You break the law. Ooh, you're a rapist. You're a murderer. You've killed. You stole. You robbed. Oh, we have to forgive. We have to forgive. Brother William, Matthew 18, 23 to 35. Thank you.
Again, I'm reading from the King James Version. Verse 23. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him, which owed him 10,000 talents. But forasmuch as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife, and his children, and all that he had, and payment to be made. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion, and loosed him, and forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out, and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence. And he laid hands on him, and took him by the throat, saying, pay me that thou owest. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay thee. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and came and told unto their Lord all that he had done. Then his Lord, after he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt, because thou desirest me. Should not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his Lord was wroth, and delivered him to the tormentors, till he should pay all that was due unto him. The last verse. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if ye from your heart forgive not every one his brother their trespasses?
We have to interpret everything in context, right? You know, the about it's in the scriptures, brother was reading. This is a parable. And what is a parable? According to Webster's, a parable is literally something cast alongside something else. Jesus' parables were stories that were cast alongside a truth in order to illustrate the truth. His parables were teaching aids. He can be thought of as extended analogies or inspired comparisons. A common description of a parable is that it is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. Jesus relied heavily on parables for a part of his life. Parable comes from Latin word parabola, from Greek parable, meaning comparison, from Webster. You know, Jesus already told Peter to forgive not 7 times, but 77 times. Why go on? Why give a parable? Because Jesus sees a problem beyond what Peter is speaking about. Peter's question raises 2 questions. One is to answer, how many times do you forgive? That was the question. The second thing was the heart problem. Where is your heart, Peter? Jesus wanted Peter to understand the kingdom of God and its king. Yes. Kingdom of heaven is similar. We all ought to follow the king. Forgiveness is not about how much you can forgive, but it is the attitude of the heart. And I just had an illustration. So I was going to ask Brother Ronald to come up to help me with this illustration. Who here is good at math? Yeah, I actually went up looking around asking everybody who's good at math. Nobody wanted to come up. There was only finally I had one brother who was willing. Pastor, can I borrow that mic from you? All right, so I was going to ask him a couple things before that. So, all right, let's have a little honest time right now. Okay. How many times in a day do you think you can annoy your spouse? Annoy. Yes. Irritate. One time. Two times. I'll say cap limited 5 times. Five? Higher. Some women say 10. Oh, Talanda keeps going up. The brother has said 7 times 77. And you have kids. How many times kids would deny their parents? In a day. One day. Oh, I'm just going to ask. It's funny. Oh, wow. All right, I'm just going to ask you a couple of questions here. So let's say, for example, we'll say all husbands are great. Little imperfection, but great. And wives are little imperfect, great. 1 times 7 is?
7.
Perfect. Oh, wow. All right, we're going to complicate her. For 7 days a week, let's say 7 times, close to perfection husband. All right, the imperfect relationships. Let's say 10 times 7.
70.
That's right. All right, it's getting complicated. Let me give you a calculator. All right, let's do this now. Now let's say 8 times a week, and there are 365 days a year. How many times in a year do you think, 8 times 365. So 8 times a day, 365 days a year. So that is going to be
$2,920.
That's a big number. All right, can we do 10 years now? Times 10. Sorry. 8 times 365 times 10.
29,200.
That's a lot. That's us in our relationships. In our relationships. Now, can I add 10 more a day and maybe we'll cap at 20 with God? 20 a day with God. Is 20 a day is a reasonable number? Can we do that math, please, real quick? 20 times a day is 20 times 365 times 10 years times 10.
Oh my God. Let me start over.
Ten times 20 times 365.
Making a little stressed.
73,000.
Wow. Thank you.
Hey, Rob.
Now let's say this. I have a table there. I didn't want to trouble poor Brother Ronald too much. You sin once a day with God. Once a day. In 50 years, it's going to be 182,000 times. Sorry, that was 18,000, my bad. I couldn't read today. So if you do 10 times a day, sin with God, in 50 years, it's going to be 182,000. Some of you have had longer lives. I am not getting on you all. I'm just saying. And some of us lived lives where we sin 100 times a day.
Come on now.
Well, maybe y'all remember those days before you got saved. I didn't add that in there. Where is 77 in these numbers? Not 7, but 7. I mean, 50 years. There are some people who lived with Christ for 50 years, walked with God 50 years, 182,000 times. You probably have sinned more than that. Just these are good estimates, conservative estimates.
Yes, yes.
You know, the parable is talking about a master who forgave his servant a huge sum of money that he's struggling to repay. The servant asks the master for an opportunity to repay, but the master forgives the servant and lets him go free. He says, "I'll repay." He says, "No," lets him go free. This is unheard of in the Old Testament times. You know, there was 10% loan forgiveness in the 1700 BC in Mesopotamia dynasty. There was one instance of 10% forgiveness of debt. Full debt forgiveness was completely unheard of in those times. The wildest thing that anybody could have ever thought of at the time in Israel, and even right now, it's the wildest thing that anybody could have. Your sins are forgiven. We build resentments for 7 sins, 3 sins, 2 sins, 1 person. What are we doing? Where is our heart? Where is our heart? The king's heart is to forgive us. His heart is to forgive us. And I've heard this a few times in different church settings. Said, forgive, but don't forget. If you, okay, now let's think about that. Look at the number there, 182,000 times. If God does not forget my forgiveness, all he's going to remember about me is the 182,000. That's a lot, it's a big number. 182,000 instances? That's a big number. Come on, you're not going to forget about that, anybody. No, that's just, no. God does not remember. He's made you a new creation. But why do you remember other people's sins? Why do you remember? God doesn't remember your sins. Why are you remembering other people's sins? And then you teach this to other people. Oh, yeah, my brother, don't forget the sins. Why are you teaching that?
You don't want to get called back up, Pastor.
And then the question that comes to me and haunts my heart here is that, do we understand the sacrifice of Jesus has made for you? Do you understand that God has forgiven you? If you do not understand the sacrifice Jesus has made for your sins, I don't know if you're a believer. If you don't understand what Jesus did for you, are you a believer? Have you been saved? What does saved means? We got saved from our sins. Not from, I don't know, some river or lake, no. From our sins. He forgave us. The master felt pity on his servant, and the master expected the servant to be like the master, to have the heart of the master. And going forward, show the example of the exemplary forgiveness is shown. But the servant did not show that. The death Jesus suffered on the cross was no ordinary death. Jesus was beaten, spit on, bruised, pierced, and died of crucifixion. It was humiliating. And let me remind you, he was God. I think it should make me angry thinking about his death. But it does not. Jesus said, "Forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." Luke 23, verses 33 to 35. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And they divided up his garment by casting lots. People stood watching. The rulers sneered at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he's the Christ of God, the chosen one." You know, Jesus did the unthinkable, unnatural, unimaginable to his enemies. He forgave. Jesus forgave the people that crucified him. Let me ask you a question here. Are you struggling to forgive the person sitting next to you? Are you struggling to forgive your spouse, your child, your parents, your coworkers, your boss? If you have not forgiven, are you faking your love for Christ? Are you really a Christ lover and follower? If you do not understand Jesus, who are you following? You cannot follow who you do not understand. This is how my Father will treat you if you do not follow forgiveness from your heart. If you're not forgiving from your heart, you do not know forgiveness in your heart. Do we remember the time when we were forgiven? You know, I did not plan this. Nobody planned this. But Shalanda spoke about testimonies today. You have a testimony. Do you remember the first time you gave your life to, the time you gave your life to the Lord? The freedom you felt, the emotional experience, and the logical freedom from slavery of sin. The freedom, the joy of the Lord. You know, that day you remember what forgiveness was. And forgiveness has not gotten weak from that day to today, nor has it gotten little. It is strong and free as ever. And that's how our depth, you know, you have to remember the time how you felt bonded in bondage to right now how your debtors would feel. You know, if you have something against somebody, if you don't release them, go back to the time. Remember that. If your chains are broken, it is your job to make sure you're not holding anyone with those gnarly chains you create. If you recognize unforgiveness in your heart and are struggling to forgive, you understand forgiveness from your heart, but the act is difficult. But we have ministers here, deacons, leaders in the church. If you're struggling, talk to them. There's an opportunity. There are a lot of ministries that can help you. Marriage ministry, there are people that can help you. There are solid leaders in our church, solid disciples, solid people. it's okay, go up, open up to them. You know, Jesus has zero sins and he's forgiven us. As I end, I want to end with a small illustration. After the death of Hitler's Nazi regime in World War II, Holocaust survivor and Christian, Corrie ten Boom, if you know who she is, she's a great author, returned to Germany to declare the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. One evening, after giving her message, she was approached by a man who identified himself as former Nazi guard from the concentration camp at Ravensbrück, where she had been held and where her sister Betsy had died. When Corrie saw the man's face, she recognized him as one of the most cruel and vindictive guards from the camp. He reached out his hand and said to her, "A fine message. How good it is to know that, as you say, all our sins are at the bottom of the sea. You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk. I was a god there, but I would like to hear it from your lips as well. Fräulein, will you forgive me?" About this encounter, Corrie writes, "I stood there. I, whose sins had again and again been forgiven and could not forgive. Betsy, her sister, had died in that place, could not erase her slow, terrible death simply for the asking. It could have been many seconds that he stood there, hand held out, but to me, it seemed hours as I wrestled with most difficult thing I ever had to do. I had to do it. I knew that. The message that God forgives is forgives has a prior condition that we forgive those who have injured us. But forgiveness is not an emotion. I knew that too. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. Jesus, help me," I prayed silently. She reached out her hand to the former guard. Corrie says that something incredible took place. She continues, "The current started in her shoulder, raced down my arm, sprang into our joined hands, and then the healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. 'I forgive you, brother,' I cried with all my heart. I had never known love so intensely as I did then. But even then, I realized it was not my love, it was the power of the Holy Spirit." As I conclude, I have an application. Are we faking our love for Christ? If Christ has fully forgiven us, our heart is to fully forgive the ones that offend us. If we do not fully forgive, we do not understand the forgiveness that God has given us. We are in many ways faking our forgiveness, in turn, our love for Christ. And as I conclude, whose heart is like the king's heart? King's heart is to forgive. He is freely forgiven. And as a citizen, our heart is meant to be like the king's heart. And our kingdom of God is not a paradise. We are going to be facing a lot of difficulties, a lot of people we might not like, a lot of people that are going to put us in harm's way, but we still have to forgive. There is no limit to forgiveness. Forgiveness is about heartful forgiveness, fully from your heart like Christ did. Your opportunity to forgive is today and from today on. Even if it was yesterday, you just missed a chance. With that, I just want to pray over you real quick and give it back to Pastor. Lord, I just pray for the hearts today, Lord. Our hearts are struggling to forgive some people. Maybe that one person that has hurt us. Lord, I just pray today that, Lord, you have forgiven us, that we find the strength in our hearts to forgive these people. It's not emotional forgiveness, but an act to fully forgive. Thank you. Amen.
Come on, give God praise this morning. Come on, give God some praise this morning. One thing I want to point out while they go it on and bring the chairs up, Zach, come on, let's go it on and do this. One thing I want to make reference to that the question was asked, and this is something that very powerful statement that he made when he asked the question, have you made your unforgiveness somebody else's? That's their identity. Your unforgiveness. That is a very powerful, powerful. Have you made your unforgiveness the identity of someone? You haven't forgiven them. You refuse to forgive them. And that's their identity, your unforgiveness. Get your mind wrapped around that if you hadn't really thought about that. That was lasting for me because that is exactly what we do. We make our unforgiveness for somebody, and that's when we looked at them, we see them in that. We see them through our lens, and we hold them in a high, we hold them accountable for that. And so a very sweet, simple, straight to the point, powerful message this morning about unforgiveness. Are you harboring any unforgiveness for somebody that did something? He made it really plain. And I love what you said when you said, when he said, if you sitting here today and you haven't forgive, then you don't know the forgiveness of God. And you, so you might not be saved. You might not be saved if you don't understand that. If you don't know that, then you're probably not saved. Or you need a lot of help. You need some serious counseling. If you don't, because to receive forgiveness, to understand it, though it might be difficult, because people don't know what, we don't know what you've been through. We don't know what somebody's done to you. But whatever's been done to you, just look to Jesus. Nothing's been done to you that hasn't already been done to Jesus. We have a God of all comfort. We have a God who has been, who knows what we feel, what it is to be rejected, lied on. He knows. And so if he can do it and you can receive his forgiveness, then why not be able to forgive? Father, I pray that somebody today is getting delivered. God delivers, is asking for deliverance, freedom today. Harboring unforgiveness. You once again, you can't go forward with unforgiveness. Unforgiveness is not even really about the other person. It's about you and what God is trying to do in you to free you. And so I pray that somebody, you got what you needed today, and go home and digest even a little bit more of what was said today. And it's